right. Well, thank you, Mike, for that great introduction. I was actually going to start by giving a little bit of an overview of kind of who I am and a little bit of my background, but basically what he said. So I won't bore you with a lot of the details. One thing I will say, I've been with the company for about 2 years now. So I joined shortly after we transitioned from a public to a private company. So I'm going to talk a little bit about that when I get into it as well. And one thing, if I can find the clicker that I do want to do in terms of kind of who I am a little bit, give you a little sense for sort of the family life and kind of who I am. So I'm married. I have two kids and a dog. And so what you can see, I brought a picture of the little ones because they're a lot cuter than I am. So I thought I'd show you what they look like. So we've got our 11-year-old daughter, Kayla, and our 13-year-old son, Eric, and then our approximately 8 or 9-year-old Australian Kelpie named Ralph. And I say approximately 8 or 9 years old because we're not really sure. We adopted him as an adult from a foster organization, and they picked him up as a stray and really don't know much about his background or where he came from or when he was born. So we're kind of using our vet's best guess at how old he is and saying he's approximately 8 or 9. One thing to know about the breed, in case you guys don't know much about Kelpies, they're a bit of kind of like a sheepdog. So he's got a very strong herding instinct. And pretty much his like mission in life, his favorite thing to do is kind of roam around the house, figure out where all of us are, and kind of herd us all into the same place. More often than not, the family room. I don't know why he like loves the family room. And typically what happens is he gets us into the family room, he makes sure we're all there, he makes sure he's got eyes on all of us, and then he jumps up on the couch and goes and takes a nap. So, and I lovingly say, by the way, fits in really well with the family because I've effectively adopted the canine version of my father. So, my mom thought that was hilarious too. All right, so what are we going to talk about today? I'm going to spend a little bit of time talking about the pet industry and then who we are in the space, how we sort of fit. I'm going to spend a little bit of time and really just a little bit of time about our transition from a public to a private organization couple years ago, so not going to spend a lot of time on that. And then really spend the most of our time talking about what's happening in the space, how things are evolving, and then what we're doing as a company to evolve along with it. I should probably bring this thing with me. All right, so the industry as a whole. You know, I'm lucky and fortunate enough, and we, there's about 50 of us here, are lucky and fortunate enough to work in an industry that is large, growing, and really diverse. Right, so you see in terms of the size of the industry, it's about a $63 billion industry, growing at about 4% per year. And there's a number of different sort of segments that we've broken out here. I'll talk about them in a second. And you can see, other than the smallest one at the top, that live pet segment, everyone is growing in kind of that low to mid single digits. Right, live pet being the one, it's smallest, it's kind of flat to slightly declining. And I mentioned the industry was really diverse. If you think about what's listed on the slide here, right, it's everything from food or consumables or kind of the grocery space to supplies, which for us is everything from, you know, pet furniture to toys to apparel and everything in between. And vet care, which is effectively the entire healthcare industry for pet, as well as services. And I'll talk a bit about what our services business is a little bit later. But we play in a variety of spaces from pets hotel to grooming to training. And then you see live pet at the top. And so if you really kind of think about this, if we were in the human space, you wouldn't really have one player standing up here able to talk about all that's going on across all these different areas. And actually, in many cases, places like the vet and a lot of the aspects of services wouldn't even really be here talking to you in a retail setting or for a retail conference. So we have the pleasure of kind of working on a lot of different sub-industries and a lot of different kind of problems and projects, which keeps it kind of interesting along the way. So why is the pet industry large and growing? The short version is there's a lot of pets, right? You can see there's almost 70 million households in the US that have pets, the overwhelming majority of which are dog or cat. And then, as you know, there's many families that have multiple dogs or multiple cats or dogs and cats. And so there's a lot more than 70 million pets in the US. So do me a favor, by show of hands, how many people in the audience have a pet? So I'm a little blinded by the lights here, but and I know I'm cheating a little because I know there's keep your hands up, I'm sorry to do this to you. There's a PetSmart section over there that clearly is cheating, but I think it's more than half of the audience here. And do me a favor, raise your hands again if you view your pet as a member of your family. Right? I'm pretty sure virtually everybody that had their, you can put your hands down now, sorry to keep making you kind of do that. You guys are not alone, right? 95% of pet parents view their pets as members of their family. It's kind of why we call them pet parents, right? We don't view pets as belongings or things or objects. They're loved ones. They're members of the family. They're our brothers and sisters or our kids or our grandkids or our best friends. And we treat them that way too. So there's this thing in the industry that we call the humanization of pets. And effectively what that is it's a... are we laughing at something? It's essentially treating our pets like humans and associating human-like behaviors on them. And you can see there's some interesting stats here that are pretty, you know, pretty sort of shocking if you sort of think about it, right? So 71%, so almost three-quarters, I won't make you raise your hands anymore, I promise, almost three-quarters of pet parents sleep in the bed with their pet. That's pretty amazing when you consider that some people have a pet tarantula. None of them are sleeping with the tarantula. None of them are sleeping with the tarantula. We're buying our pets presents, right? Almost two-thirds of us are buying our pets holiday presents. Almost half are buying our pets birthday presents. And if you think about how many folks like myself and our family really have no idea when our pet's birthday is, that's a shocking figure and really just an excuse to go spoil our pet, right? And then about a quarter of us are dressing our pets in clothing. And as you can see from the picture up there, they often do a better job pulling the look off than their human counterparts. Right, they're super cute. All right, so who are we? How do we play in the space? The short version is we're the largest player in the space. We're, so you know, pun intended, we're the big dog, right? So we have more than 1,500 stores in the US and Canada. So we have a lot of locations out there, over 55,000 associates. We play across the entire spectrum of the industry that I described earlier. So we've got a lot of SKUs to sort of meet the needs across all that entire spectrum. So over 11,000 SKUs. We're the number one player in the services space, and I'll spend a little bit of time talking about that in a little while. And then we've got a number of different sort of assets in the portfolio, ranging across the brick and mortar side of the business, which is the largest part of the company, to some e-commerce sites, and then some educational and adoption-oriented sites as well. So a couple that you may not be familiar with, the blue circle, or circle-y, square-y thing, Ask PetMD, that's an app that effectively allows you to do research and go get information and get vet-qualified responses for questions or concerns that you have related to the health of your pet. And AllPaws is another site, as a company we acquired sometime within the last year, and is really focused on helping match up adoptable pets to folks looking to adopt a new family member. So think of it like a searchable database of adoptable pets. And many of you have grabbed me in the hall and asked about the recent press release that we had from a couple days ago. I won't spend a lot, I will talk about that a little bit, but I won't spend a lot of time talking about that. But obviously, clearly, we continue to grow our portfolio of assets and are looking to continue to add and grow the company. And then finally, we've got a very large partnership with Banfield to offer full-service vet hospitals effectively in approximately 900 of our stores. So we have a huge presence across the entire industry and are a big player in sort of the commerce side of the space. But that's not really all we do. We spend a lot of time, actually, on the animal welfare side of the space as well. And through our PetSmart charities, we are actually the largest contributor to animal welfare in the United States, right? So we are a... Right? We actually have partnerships with literally thousands of animal welfare organizations across the country to help make sure that we can have adoptable pets in all of our stores pretty much all the time. So we have adoption events consistently across the chain. Periodically we do, once a quarter we do, something we call the National Adoption Weekend, which is a very focused, nationwide, every store at the same time adoption event. And to kind of put this into scale and to kind of give you guys a sense for sort of the magnitude of this, this year we will adopt out over 500,000 dogs and cats out of our stores. And since we began, oh, you can clap again, because it's awesome, right? You're going to want to clap again, because actually, since we've been doing this in the early 90s, we've saved over 7 million lives through this program. And I feel like it's like a State of the Union address, right? So, you know, and one thing to point out, this is not just something that, you know, we get to come do and say at conventions like this and make ourselves look and feel good. This is actually something that's really important and critical to us as a team, and we take as seriously as things that are driving the business. So as a member of the senior team, we get together every week and we talk about the metrics that are driving the business and the metrics that are important to us as a team. And along with sales and margin and expenses and profitability, which you would imagine every, you know, retailer is going to be talking about, we actually talk about the number of adoptions that happened in our stores in the prior week and what we're doing with respect to adoption events in the coming week. So this is something that we take really, really seriously. So switching gears for a second, going to talk a little bit about our transition from a public to a private company. The short version of the story is, circa 2014, the investment community felt like we maybe were playing it a little bit too conservatively, a little bit too safe, and there was an opportunity to really take some of the cash we were generating and instead of return it back to shareholders and sort of hold on to it, really drive and invest the business for growth. led to an acquisition by private equity firms led by BC Partners out of their New York office in early 2015. And as often happens in transactions like that, along with the transaction, they brought some new members, some new thinking onto the leadership team, including Michael Massey, our CEO, who spoke last year, and myself. And one of the first things we did as a new team, we wanted to kind of get out there and gather some information and get an understanding of how we were viewed, both by our associate base as well as by our customer base. So we talked to pretty much our entire associate base, and then about 20,000 pet parents. So these are our customers and customers of our competitors. And we sort of asked them, how are we viewed? What are the things that we're really good at? What are opportunities to really drive the business forward? And the short version is, look, I mean, we're the big player in the space. They view us as highly convenient. We've got a lot of stores. We play across the entire spectrum. We're a great one-stop shop. We've got a great assortment. But one of the interesting themes that came through really consistently, both from our associate base and our customers, was we had an opportunity to really kind of differentiate who we are. We play in the space of love, and we need a way to build an emotional connection and really kind of connect and differentiate ourselves relative to everybody else in the market. So the way we did that is we sort of started with a new vision and mission for the company that really kind of helped set for us that sort of North Star of where we wanted to head, where we sort of aspire to be. So I'm going to throw our vision up on the screen, and that tagline is kind of what I just mentioned. It really is kind of that who we aspire to be, how we want to vet all of our decisions against to make sure we're heading in the right direction. And by the way, who we aspire to be means we're not there yet, right? This is where we want to go. This is where we want to get to. And it all centers around those first few words. We love pets. Right, we obviously love our own pets, that's a given. But we love caring for your pets when they're in our store and when they're in our care for things like hotel or grooming or services. And we love adoptable pets and hopefully are helping find them their forever homes. This is not only about our own pets. We are generally a company of animal lovers, and we want to be there to help care for and fulfill and make sure that you and your pets have happy, fulfilling lives. So we love pets, and we believe pets make us better people. PetSmart will be the trusted partner to pet parents and pets in every moment of their lives. So what does that mean? That pretty much means no matter what product or service or concern or information or advice you need or want, we want to be the one you look to be your partner in that journey that you and your pet are going on, and that we want to be the one to sort of help you meet that need. Right? So if the vision is all about aspiring to make sure that we're the first place you look when you have a need with respect to your pet, our mission is all about how we're going to reach that. So every day, every connection, PetSmart's passionate associates help bring pet parents closer to their pets so they can live more fulfilled lives. Right? So the vision, again, is about if you have a need, we want to be the one you look to meet that need. And our mission is when you come to us, we actually want to meet that need. Right? So it's pretty. They fit pretty well together. And I've actually got a video that I think really helps bring the mission and vision to life that I think doesn't work with the button. So if I can ask the guys on the AV to sort of play it, that'd be great. It's always fun to bring, cute puppies and kittens and birds at dance videos, right? All right, so we've got a great vision and mission, and we know where we want to head, but unfortunately, that's not enough to guarantee that we're actually going to be successful, right? You've been hearing a lot this morning. We're living in a world that's constantly changing, that is evolving, and that our consumers are getting more sophisticated and smarter all the time. You've heard a lot about convenience, right? Convenience is really important to to customers these days. You heard a lot, you know, about sort of quality and value, right? Price alone isn't going to get it done these days. Customers are really smart, and it's really easy for them to search and understand what prices are out there, but they want great quality goods, so they need great value. And I mentioned earlier about our opportunity to really create that emotional connection and differentiate ourselves. In terms of the category and sort of the competitive set, things are evolving there as well. There are large established players, both in sort of the product side as well as on sort of the retail side, but there's a lot of new entrants sort of coming on board and playing and entering the space. There's even a number of players, FDM, by the way, stands for Food, Drug, Mass. So there's a number of players that haven't necessarily been focused on the pet space historically that are starting to expand their presence in and grow into the space as well. And obviously online is becoming a big deal, right? It's sort of one of those sort of double-edged swords, or the one negative of being in sort of a large growing industry is it's attractive for other folks to try to come in and to grow and expand their presence in. So we need to create a strategy that's, you know, all around a number of things that we're going to do to differentiate ourselves, to build that emotional connection, and to, you know, to become that trusted partner. So if you think through to our vision about becoming the trusted partner for us, it was really all about creating a strategy that put our customer really at the center of what we were doing. So there's five things that I want to talk to you about underlying that. And what I'll do is I'll spend a little bit of time at a very high level on this slide, and then we'll sort of double-click into each of them as we go on. So in terms of convenience, right, to some degree, that's all about opening up new stores. We have a lot of our industry, a lot of our space that really requires, so think about our services business, really requires kind of a brick-and-mortar location. And our customers repeatedly told us they don't want to drag their pets all over town. So we need to be convenient. We need to open up new stores and be near where they want to shop. We need to have the right product and put it in the right place, right? It's about an assortment that is trend right and relevant, and brands that resonate with our customers, as well as tailoring and skewing the assortment to meet the needs of the local trade area. We're calling that localization. We need to build stores that are interesting. You've heard a lot about this today, right? We need to build stores that are interesting and exciting and fun that make people want to come shop. And we need to differentiate ourselves with things like our services business that have very high barriers to entry and are hard for our competition to grow into, or hard for the players that aren't necessarily focused on the pet space to grow dramatically into. No retailer can have a strategy these days without talking about what they're going to do in the digital space or online and with respect to omnichannel. And as I mentioned, I'm sure most of you either before this conversation have read our press release or have Googled it while I've been talking on your phone. But we announced earlier this week that we signed an agreement to acquire Chewy.com, who is a large player in the pet online space. And so obviously this is an area, I can't really say much more than that, but this is an area that we are clearly focused on, and we're looking to drive and grow not only in the brick and mortar side, but on the online space as well. And like many others that you heard today, we are also focused not only on what it means for sort of online or e-commerce, but we're thinking in terms of omnichannel as well. And in-store pickup, we call it ISPU or you know, BOPIS, which you heard earlier, is a very big part of how we're thinking about it and how we're going to leverage our store base to allow our customers to buy online, pick up in store, or even ship from store or deliver from store to their houses. So that's a big area that we're focused on. And then finally, I want to talk about the emotional connection that we're building through our current program that's going on right now called Buy a Bag, Give a Meal. And I will describe that in a bit more detail in a minute. So in terms of convenience, the moment we're talking about new store openings, right? And so you can see on the chart, just to anchor you on what you're looking at here, the bars are in any given year the number of new stores that we opened in that year. The line is just basically the total number of stores that we have at that moment in time across the chain. And what you can see is we were growing pretty significantly leading up to kind of that 2008 timeframe, right? Opening about 100 stores a year. And then like many others in the retail space, we scaled back pretty significantly starting in around 2009. And we went from over 100 stores to kind of in the 50 or under for most of the years. The interesting thing, and by the way, for a lot of good reasons, right? The interesting thing is, while we scaled back because of the fact that we're in an industry that is large and growing, that isn't necessarily what happened across all of the players. And if I would, I don't have it, but if I would put up here the number of competitive doors that actually opened up from like 2010 to 2015, it would actually be a shockingly high number relative to what's been going on in general in retail. And so we've been losing ground. We've been sort of ceding, you know, convenience share, if you will, to our competition, and we need to kind of turn that around. So in 2016, we opened up 70 stores, which was about 20 more than we opened up the year prior. And while we're not talking publicly about what we're doing this year, what I can say is our plans are to open a meaningfully larger number of doors in 2017 than we did in 2016. So if I were back here next year and I were to show you this chart, the number for 2017 would be bigger than 70. So I mentioned product and assortment here, right? So we need to have products in the market that are on trend, that resonate, that have brands that are relevant and that resonate with our customer base. So there's two examples that we have on the page here. On the right-hand side, Only Natural Pet. So this is a brand that we own. It was actually founded in Boulder, Colorado, and it is all about a healthy, natural sort of pinnacle of nutrition, which is sort of the top of the nutrition space, outdoor lifestyle brand. And if you think about some of the trends that are going on in the human space and the reality of kind of the humanization of pets and us thinking about our pets as members of the family and us wanting for our pets what we want for ourselves, as we want to eat healthier and be more active, we need products and food for our pets that allow them to eat healthier and to promote an active, healthy lifestyle for them as well. So this is all about having products that are on trend and relevant for what our customers want. I mentioned we also need brands that resonate and that are relevant. So we had a partnership that we launched earlier this year in partnership with Ellen DeGeneres. It's our Ed by Ellen DeGeneres product line. And with respect to pet, it is exclusive to us. And this was a great opportunity for us to connect with somebody who's obviously wildly popular and very relevant today, has a huge fan base, but also is an enormous pet lover and talks about pets on her show all the time and is clearly passionate about the space, right? So from our perspective, great brand, great high-quality product. From her perspective, partnering with the number one player in a space that she's really passionate about. So it's not only about having the great assortment and the right assortment, it's about tailoring the assortment to understanding what the customers in the trade area that you're serving want and need. So I'll give you an example of this. If you live in an urban environment, or if we have a store in an urban environment, if you think about where folks are living mostly in that environment, it's going to be condominiums or apartments. They're more likely to have cats and small breed dogs, like smaller dogs, than huge dogs that are usually out and about running around in the yard, because they don't have yards. So if we build a store in an urban environment, if we have a store in an urban environment, we need to skew the space allocation towards cat and small dogs, and away from products that are more relevant for large dogs. Doesn't mean we're going to have nothing for large dogs, but it means we want to make sure that we have the broadest possible assortment and enough depth of product, so enough units of any given SKU, that when the pet parents in the local trade area come into the store, that we're not out of stock and that we have the products that they're looking for. Because the worst thing you can be these days is out of stock when somebody comes. It might be convenient for you to be right next to them. It is very inconvenient for them to make a trip to your store and not have them find what they're looking for. So I mentioned we got to build stores that are you've been seeing this all day, right? That are interesting, exciting, inviting. And we need to do the same thing. It's been a very long time since we really, really rethought what our store prototype looks like. My real long time, like 10, 15 years. So we need to take a step back. What we're in the middle of, what you see here on the page, this is just a rendering. It's a concept. It's a prototype that's not actually a real store. But we're partnering right now with a design firm to really, from a blank sheet of paper, rethink what our store looks like and how it operates. And you can see from the concept kind of the things we're thinking about, right? We're looking for an open, warm, well-lit, interesting environment. We're looking for a space that you can go and kind of check in and get information and advice on the products and the services that you might need, or that you need any information, with an aisle configuration that sort of fosters exploration and kind of going in and exploring nooks and crannies in the store. So our plan is we've got two stores that we've approved that we're going to actually associate whatever the final concept is. We're going to open that up later on this year, and then hopefully take what we learned from those stores and build them into our prototype for all the new stores we open up sometime in the middle of next year. So lots of really cool, interesting things going on the store design as well. So I mentioned our services business, and leveraging our services really is a key differentiator. And this is an area of our business that, if you think about, right, I talked about the industry and the lines are kind of blurring, and players that aren't necessarily focused on the pet space because of what's going on in the industry are starting to expand their presence. And the online players are growing pretty significantly in the space as well. Well, this is a really difficult business to enter. There are lots of barriers to entry to sort of build out and really get a robust services business going. So this is an opportunity for us to really kind of take that differentiation point and leverage it. Our largest business within services, so we're the number one player in services. Our largest business in the services place is Salon. And we are, by the way, not only the leader in terms of sort of sales and volume in the salon business, we are actually also the leader on sort of the quality side of salon as well. We have the most robust training and certification program in the industry. And you can see from the picture over there, we regularly win awards at kind of grooming shows and pet expos. Our groomers regularly win awards because of their sort of skill and training and qualifications. And actually, these are like no joke awards. If you can kind of look at the picture, they apparently win Academy Awards for this stuff. That's like an Oscar they gave out, which is pretty cool. That's pretty cool. We also have training across the portfolio. So we have training across all of our stores. And then in approximately 200 of our stores, we have what we call a pets hotel, which allows for overnight boarding as well as doggy day camp. So really, really great, interesting business. And like I said earlier, we're lucky to be in an industry that lets us kind of play in these spaces, because this isn't traditionally the kind of stuff that retailers get to be a part of. I've got a very short video to show you right after this. It's a commercial we actually shot and ran late last year for a services business. And it's one of my favorite commercials that we've done. So I want to share it with you because I think you'll find it exciting if it plays.
Give it to me, I'm worth it.
Cute, right? I can see a bunch of you out there look like you need a haircut. We don't do humans. All right, let's see if I can get back to where I was. All right, so I talked a little bit about Omni. I'm actually, per what I talked about earlier, not going to spend a lot of time on this, but obviously given some of the announcements from earlier this week, we are very focused on growing both our online business and, as I mentioned earlier, kind of integrating in and thinking like a true omnichannel retailer and how online and what happens from a commerce perspective online also ties in with the stores and things like in-store pickup and shipment from store to home or delivery from store to home are big areas of focus for us. Unfortunately, the news is new enough that I'm just going to point you to our press release here, and it's about all I know, as well as all I can say. So I'm going to move on to that emotional connection and our buy a bag, give a meal program that we have going on here, and this program sort of fits the bill as both a hugely impactful and super simple program to understand. So the way the program works is effectively for every bag of dog or cat food that we sell for the balance of the year, so any size, any brand, any channel, we're gonna donate a meal to a pet in need, right? And if you sort of think back, right, the early bits of feedback we got right after we sort of did that big survey of our associates and our customers was that we had an opportunity, we play in the space of love, we really needed to build that emotional connection. And if you think about it from the associate perspective, this clearly fits with who we are as a company, right? Our vision starts with we love pets. We are the number one player in the charitable space from an animal welfare perspective and are heavily focused on helping pets in need, helping homeless pets, ending pet homelessness, and finding forever homes for homeless pets. But this is a way for us to connect not only with our associates, but with our customers as well, and to have them help us participate in giving back to pets in need. And I'm gonna tell you, I'll tell you a story that really helps sort of connect the dots on this. So our president of Canada was in the office for meetings last week or the week before, and he was talking about how he was out in stores and he was sort of communicating the program to pet parents. And there was one woman he was speaking with that was in line holding a approximately 30-pound bag of food for her dog, and was explaining the program to her that, you know, this is great, you're gonna be a part of helping donate a meal to a pet in need through your purchase of that bag. And then when he explained the program, she actually went back to the aisle, dropped off the big bag of food, and grabbed three smaller, like 10-pound bags of food, and, you know, went to the register and purchased those. And he was having a conversation with her afterwards, and he sort of chatted with her and said, you know, this is amazing, you know, tell me about what you were thinking. And basically, the way she described it was, this is a really amazing thing that you guys are doing, and I want to be a part of, and I want to help through this. I'm going to get the food I need for my dog, but because you're not limiting it to size or quantity or weight, I now can participate through this and donate three times, or three meals in this case, or help you donate three meals in this case to pets in need instead of just one, right? So think about that, and think about how that sort of, this program really motivated that customer to do something differently. She had to carry a 30-pound bag of food back to the aisle, drop it off, grab three new bags of food, and then, by the way, there are economies of scale on the purchase of food, right? One large bag for 30 pounds costs less than three 10-pound bags. So she was motivated enough that it was worth her walking back to the aisle and carrying the food and paying a little bit more to help donate more food to pets in need. So this is a huge, really impactful program. And to kind of help put a little bit of a scale on this for you guys, our forecast is that we are going to donate over 60 million meals to pets in need through this program this year. That's million with an M. All right, I'm looking at the timer. It's going to go yellow pretty soon. So I'm going to, there's one more video that I have. It's actually the commercial that we're running right now, which is really focused in on this program. And I think it does an amazing job kind of explaining what it is that we're trying to do. And of course, it's another excuse to show you kind of cute puppies and kittens.
Lucky is a lucky dog, but not every pet is as lucky as Lucky. Because not every pet has you. So we came up with a little idea. This year, when you buy any bag of dog or cat food at PetSmart, we'll give a meal to a pet in need somewhere else. It's like this. When Roger in Richmond grabs grub for Ralphie, Charlie in Chattanooga chows down. And when Becky brings breakfast to her boxer Bailey, Dougie the Dachshund does a dance. When Pearl eats, Peanut eats. When Wolf wolfs, George gorges. And when Moose mows down a meal in Montana, Cuddles in Kansas cuddles up to a bowl. All this to make sure that when Claire takes Cosmo back to her cozy cabin in Kingston, Lola left behind still gets to lick her chops. Until one day, Lola gets to return the favor. This year, when you buy any bag of food, we'll give a meal to a pet in need. It's that simple. PetSmart, for the love of pets.
So we're obviously extremely excited about this program and you know, just can't wait to share it with everybody. So by the way, for every bag that all of you buy, I saw a lot of hands up there, for the rest of the year, we'll donate to a pet in need. So come shop our stores. All right, so I'm going to wrap up here. Lots of really cool things going on in retail. I think you're hearing from a lot of us today that there is a lot of really, I think Sarah said it well, retail is not dead. There's a lot of really cool things across the space. It is a great place to work. I personally obviously think the pet space is also a great place to work, and hopefully gave you guys a sense for some of the interesting, exciting things that we are doing. So I'm going to stop there, and I think we've got a couple of minutes for questions, if there are any. Thank you, guys. Oh, there we go.
Oh.
I think there's somebody over here. Yeah.
I heard along the way that you were investigating smaller scale formats. Can you talk a little bit about that?
Yeah, so back a couple of years ago, we had opened up a number of what we called sort of micro stores. So our normal stores, just to sort of help anchor the question, are on the order of 20,000 square feet. And most of the stores that we, when we sort of think about our normal store, on the order of kind of that 15 to 20,000 square feet. For a number of years, kind of back in that sort of 12, 13, 14, 15 range, we were exploring a concept that was a little bit more like 6,000 square feet that we called our micro stores. And I'll tell you that that's not really the focus that we have going forward. It turns out that when we're trying to play across sort of that wide variety of products and services and be that one-stop shop, that we really had a hard time fitting everything that we really needed to into those stores. And it turns out we're better off, in our case, because again, we don't want folks coming in thinking we have something that isn't there and then they get disappointed. We're actually really focused more in on the larger stores right now.
Okay,
we do have, I should actually say, we do have a couple of concept stores that we've launched that are a little bit unique and different. So there's a couple, I want to say 3 to 5 stores that we opened up last year that are a little bit more kind of services-focused stores, like a heavy salon store with a little bit of merchandise and things like that. So we're kind of exploring and testing other concepts, but for the most part, our predominant focus is actually on the larger store.
Great. I'm going to jump in now before somebody else gets in. I'm over to your right. You're completely blinded.
I gotta
blinded.
Tell you, it's like blind. This
yeah,
is why none of
I know.
Us know
it's
where
like,
you guys are.
It's like confess right now.
I know it is.
As a parent of a multi-breed household, I know and I love your store. So let me just give you that bias right away. And I very much appreciate what you're doing with animal welfare and with your organic food. You're actually really getting kind of leading edge into animal wellness, which I think is terrific. And that trend is going to continue probably well into the future, no pun intended. I have a question. I know you partner with Banfield, and so I know that you don't actually own that, but you do work with it, which is wonderful. One of the toughest thing for pet parents is the increasing costs on vet bills. Certainly people medicine has been like really regulated, and I don't even want to go there because it's really controversial, but vet bills don't have that kind of cap on there, and many people can't afford their pets. Can you talk about what you're doing or what you might have tossed around doing as far as helping people that it's great that you're going to, you know, buy a bag, get a meal, that's fabulous, but what about the vet area? Can you do anything with on the other side of animal health? Thanks.
Yeah, so it's a good question, and to your point, we have a great partnership with Banfield. It is at this point, at arm's length. We used to have a small ownership stake in the company, but it is we no longer own a stake in the company. There's a couple things, actually. It's an interesting thing. So we've identified a similar sort of concern that you had, where similar to kind of what's going on in the human space, right? Healthcare for pets are getting it's getting expensive, and it's a meaningful amount of money in terms of just caring for your pets. And one of the things that we've actually spent a little bit of time, and I do mean a very little bit of time, thinking through is pet insurance or health insurance for pets, right? So the reason why it's not as big a burden on many of us on the human side is because we all have insurance, right? To some degree, we have a little bit of that safety net if something catastrophic happens, and we know that, you know, there's a deductible and there's, you know, co-pays and things like that, but for the most part, there's going to be somebody there to provide sort of a financial backstop. It's a very, very, very small industry at this point, but there are a number of players, small players in the pet insurance space, and while we have really nothing that I can share that we're doing, we're not actively doing anything in the space right now, it is an area that we've sort of identified that at some point we probably do need to think about and do need to explore how we either play in the space or who we partner with to sort of drive, because to your point, healthcare is a ever-increasing sort of part of vet bills. And I will say it's not only the day-to-day, right? There's a lot of stories of folks who have to make, you know, really tough decisions of their pet had an accident and it's going to be, you know, a $6,000 or $7,000 surgery. And we want to obviously be a part of trying to find solutions that sort of mitigates that financial burden, that doesn't sort of force tough decisions on households that obviously love their pets as much as we do. But unfortunately, nothing that we're working on, like, imminently.
So I'm right straight back up here.
I'm just going to look in that general. Okay, oh, there we go.
I'm
I got
right
you.
There you go. So I'm Anita Bapu. I'm one of the faculty members here. And I have a question that potentially is controversial. I don't think of it as that. But I wondered if you have strategically considered pet access over pet ownership, given changing trends with ownership of homes, the size of homes, and quite frankly, a different generation in terms of commitment. You know, have you even considered what that might mean for your business if indeed ownership goes down versus access to pets, so pet therapy?
You know, we actually have not spent a lot of time sort of thinking about that. You know, the good news is we happen to be, if I sort of went back, I won't go back to it, but if I went back to sort of the chart, actually ownership of pets, the number of households that have pets over time have actually been growing. So assuming I understood your question correctly related to, you know, access to pets and, you know, are we going to continue to see pet ownership rise? We think that's actually going to continue to happen, and that we are, you know, obviously through our work with the pet, the animal welfare organizations, we are very focused on sort of trying, you know, our best to end pet homelessness and to find as many forever homes for pets as possible. So hopefully, you know, we can continue through that effort to help continue to grow the number of pet owning households or the number of multi-pet owning households through that activity. All right. Well, saved by the bell.
The last ask back there, that might be an application opportunity for like a mobile app to rent out your pet for during the day.
No, kind of like Airbnb for your pet.
I'm gonna write up a business plan now. Are you guys doing anything with the you know, quantified pet or smart pet technology, or, you know, like collars and what have you, to help use that to drive some more of your business insights?
Yeah, I mean, that's something that the merchant team looks at all the time, new products and services, and not So services in that frame, not services like hotel or training or grooming or things like that. It is something that we've talked about, that we've looked at. I actually don't know, candidly, you know, where we are, how far down the path we are on that. Actually, I'd recommend that at a break, grab Mike Sapp, who introduced me. He runs our buying organization, and so he'd probably have deeper insights into, you know, where that is in terms of the thinking and when that might come online. All right. Thank you all.